Welcome. I'm Sebastian Mahfood, and you're listening to WCAT Radio, the on-air wing of En Route Books and Media, bringing you the dulcet sounds of Catholic wisdom.
Welcome to the Catholic Mama, where you'll learn how to deepen and defend your faith, find comfort as we share the vocation of parenthood, and learn how to raise your children confidently Catholic. I'm your host, Christine Mooney Flynn. Let's get started. Hello, and welcome back to the Catholic Mama. I'm your host, Christine Mooney Flynn. And once again, because I just can't get enough of them, is my husband, Pat. Hi, Pat.
Hello, wife.
Hello, husband.
Good to be on the Catholic Mama again.
This is how we relax in the evenings when all the kids are in bed, just sitting around having a little fireside chat, huh?
Yeah, well, this is what, take four of this episode?
Yes. Somebody started crying. The baby woke up.
Dog trounced around.
Yeah, we have a St. Bernard, and she breathes very heavily. And she came walking right by the microphone, and it sounded very bizarre.
It's a Catholic podcast. We want to keep it that way. Yeah.
St. Bernard, though. Mm-hmm. She could come on the show.
Did you look up the history?
I didn't. I should do that. Yeah. So somebody was telling us about the history of the St. Bernard dog and how it had to do with St. Bernard.
Saint person.
Well, it is. Go figure with a name like that.
Who would have ever guessed?
Now, my mother's parish growing up, it was St. Bernard, which I never even thought of in relation to the dog until since we owned one.
Yeah. But I am curious what the connection is, how that dog picked up that name.
I'll look it up. Everybody,
we'll do it.
Wait with bated breath.
We'll do an amazing facts episode.
The only thing I know about St. Bernard's, the dogs, is they are not nearly as useful as they once were. And they didn't initially look like the Beethoven type dog that we know and love today. Mm-hmm. But I guess that has changed in 100 and some years of breeding. Mm-hmm. Well, after that brief meandering into canine life. What we had in store the past three times that we tried to talk about this or do this episode is defending faith. So it was very interesting that I'm kind of glad it didn't work out for us to record this earlier, because in the church bulletin this week, you know, they have the opening letter, and they did a brief recap of a survey that they did for the parishioners. And the two main things that came out were catechesis, or, you know, faith, learning it, the education, and then how to share it. Mm-hmm. So defending your faith and sharing your faith. And you really can't share your faith confidently until you can defend your faith confidently. And for better or for worse, we are constantly given opportunities in our day-to-day lives to in some way defend our faith, whether that is just standing up for what we believe in any social issue, mm-hmm. or when people directly ask you, why do you believe this? Why would you believe in God? Well, actually, so we'll talk about this anyway. The reason, Pat, is you're here and you know this as well, because we already talked about this, is you are so good at the philosophical part of getting to why does God exist and can we prove it? And a few other of those very fundamental philosophical questions that you really need to answer before you can move on and get into some of the very specifics to the Catholic faith, which we will do in another episode. Mm-hmm. So with that in mind, Pat has his own podcast. Now, is it the Pat Flynn Show about Sunday
School?
I don't
want to start self-promoting all over the Catholic Mama.
No, that's okay. Because what Pat's promised to do is he has a very philosophical mind, which I don't share as much. And I'm not sure how many people actually do. So for my sake now, he's not dumbing this down or whatever in any capacity, but he is going to talk in layman's terms. He's promised, so that I can understand what he's saying, and hopefully you, the listeners, will as well. So, but if you want to get in more detail,
yes,
you can head over
the Pat Flynn Show,
the Sunday School episodes.
Sunday School episodes. We dive deep into philosophy in there, and well, I think this is appropriate. This is good. And the first thing about what we call this apologetics work, when we're making a case for Christianity or Catholicism, we're being apologists when we're defending or promoting.
Not like I'm saying I'm sorry.
Yeah, not like we're saying we're sorry. We're not sorry for being Catholics or Christians. At least I certainly hope not, unless we've done something wrong in the name of Christianity or Catholicism. Then we should be sorry. But that isn't the apologetics that we're meaning. When we say apologetics, we mean very much like what C.S. Lewis was an apologetic. He gave philosophical arguments for the faith. And I don't think that everybody has to have a very deep philosophical understanding of arguments for, say, the existence of God or why we accept the resurrection of Jesus or things like that. And that's an objection I hear a lot, is people say, well, I'm not very philosophically minded. I'm not sure if these arguments will be very good. And the thing I say is, well, that's fine, because neither are most other people. So chances are you're not going to be getting into, you know, arguments with PhD existentialists like I was doing all day, which was fun and productive. And oftentimes just simply laying out some arguments is enough to allow you to start to share your faith. Just showing that you do have reasons, even if you don't fully unpack those reasons or dive as deep into those reasons as possible, is often enough to open the conversation with people. So often, and it depends who you're talking to, but so often people just assume that faith is blind, that you're just taking things to heart because somebody told you them are true, that you don't actually have any reason. So what I have found is just simply listing the reasons, even if you don't go through all of the philosophical arguments, is often enough to remove a certain bias or prejudice against people.
Yeah. And I will say real quick too, we've gotten into, we'll just call them conversations, not debates, but we've gotten into conversations together with other people who don't share our same beliefs. And the one thing that I think, Pat, that you do very well is they might come out with, you're swinging with some very non-essential argument. Mm-hmm. as being like, oh, let's just throw out all of Christianity or all of Catholicism because of this thing that I don't particularly agree with. Mm-hmm. And I think that you've done a very good job of saying, well, hold on a second. We're not going to start the conversation there. We've got to go way back. Do you believe in God? Is that our baseline? Mm-hmm. So I think that's interesting that even if people are calling on you to defend your faith,
Yeah, you're making a good point. Is when it comes to apologetics work, the first thing you have to do is find what is the most fundamental point of disagreement with people. Because sometimes where people will object is not the most fundamental point of disagreement. So you have to kind of ask a lot of questions. So when it comes to the Catholic faith, I say, okay, let's start from the very first premise. Does God exist? Are we dealing with an atheist here, or are we dealing with a Protestant, right? These are very different arguments. And sometimes people will object to Catholicism or Christianity or church on a moral level, saying, oh, well, look, the church has done all these terrible things. And I don't think we have to deny that the church has done terrible things, but we could easily suggest that that's the wrong expectation to have at the church, that it's run by angels or something like that. Certainly Catholics and Christians don't claim that that is. But their primary objection might be, and often is, much deeper than that. And that's something I like to try to uncover in discussions with people, is where is our very first point of disagreement? Is it on God? Is it on Jesus, the Son of God? These are kind of the major hinge points that I've found. Okay, somebody might be an atheist, so we got to talk about the arguments for the existence of God. Or maybe somebody does believe in God, but they don't accept the resurrection of Jesus. Then, all right, well, let's address that. Let's talk about arguments for the resurrection of Jesus. Or maybe they do accept the resurrection of Jesus, but they don't accept certain Catholic positions on things. So where you start to engage in apologetics, it depends on where the person's doubts are or objections are. And I think that the first thing you have to do, if you're going to be effective at this, is really just listen for a little bit and ask some questions and try and find out where to even start the argument.
That's just the basis for any good conversation.
Yeah.
That's what you should do. Any conversationalist, just listen, mm-hmm. ask questions.
And I remember, because we were having this conversation one time, and somebody was objecting to Jesus on the grounds that she thought he was married to Mary Magdalene or things like that.
Exactly, yeah.
And first off, it's important to note that from a historical perspective, that is like the fringe of the fringe of the fringe position. This is like the Da Vinci Code, not anything that scholars actually agree on or even suspect. But all that aside, I would say, well, it really isn't relevant, because even if he was married, and she wasn't denying the resurrection. But yet she was kind of throwing away Jesus on the basis that the church didn't agree that he was ever married to Mary Magdalene. So it was kind of an invalid objection in the sense that it had nothing to do with the thing that made Jesus significant, was that he claimed to be the Son of God and rose from that. So I just wanted to bring the argument to the relevant point. Do you believe that Jesus was who he said he was? If so, then we can talk about all these conspiracy theories about the church and Jesus. But let's talk about that fundamental point first. And really, we never even got there, because there was a mean people in that conversation. But when I entered this conversation, I noticed people were having all these arbitrary arguments about the life of Jesus. Was he married to Mary Magdalene? All these things. And those are easy to refute, and they're worth refuting. But I wanted to know, what is the main objection here? Because that's that. If you establish the resurrection, then you have Christianity, right? You have some form of Christianity, and that's a win as far as I'm concerned. And then if you have a form of Christianity that thinks that Jesus was married, we can deal with that down the line. But I want to know if you're at Christianity first or if you're not. That's the most important question to me.
So with some of these more Catholic questions, we'll get into those in a later episode. The Eucharist, veneration of Mary, all those things will come down the line. But first, as Pat has already said, we kind of have to go back to the very start. So let's start with that. Can you help our listeners be able to understand logically and philosophically why God exists?
Yeah. I think it's important when we're talking about faith to have a definition of faith. And faith is believing in that which you have good reason to believe. Faith is simply trusting really in that which you have good reason to believe. So when we talk about faith from a Christian perspective or from a Catholic perspective, we really mean that it is superior to reason, not inferior to reason. We should always have good reasons for our positions of faith. And I'll tell you, whether you have those reasons or not, they exist. And I think it's learning at least some of them if you want to be an effective evangelist and defender of your faith. Is this water for me?
Yes.
Thank you. So let's start from the very position. Do we have good reasons to believe that God exists? Well, I think we have excellent reasons to believe that God exists. You said earlier, can we prove that God exists? That depends what you mean by proof. Can we prove it like a geometric equation? No, or through empirical investigation? No, because that would be in philosophy called a category mistake. Everything we know about God philosophically would put him beyond the universe. So we shouldn't expect an immaterial, timeless, spaceless being to be something we can find with a microscope or telescope. It's just so you have to have some clarity there. As for arguments for God's existence, I do many episodes where I go quite in depth at these arguments and really try to draw them out and go through the various objections. But I think there's some very simple ones that we can start with. One that C.S. Lewis started with in Mere Christianity that I spent a lot of time arguing today and in Sunday school and on the radio station is the moral argument, which is a very simple argument that goes like this. And we can jam around on it a little bit. Premise one, premises are steps in an argument. So I'll define these as we go a little bit. Premise one, if God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist. Now, what is an objective moral value? It's actually quite simple. To say something is an objective moral value means that there is something such as truly right and truly wrong, regardless of what anybody thinks about it. So to say that the Holocaust was objectively wrong, we mean that it was wrong even though that the people committing it didn't think it was wrong. And obviously we would ground these objective moral values against the standard, which is the goodness of God. That's the Christian and Catholic position. But so if God does not exist, then objective moral values do not exist, right? We really are left with some type of moral relativism. There's no way to ground objective moral values unless you have some type of transcendent.
Right. So then if moral relativism was accurate, mm-hmm. then there's no reason to say that the Holocaust was bad.
That's right.
Because they didn't think it was the people right. perpetrating it didn't think it was bad. So,
You might not like it, but yeah.
That is a problem.
But this is the part of the power of this argument, right? So if God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist. That's premise one. Premise two, however, says that objective moral values do exist. And then the conclusion necessarily follows that God exists.
Right.
So it's a very simple argument to memorize. I like simple arguments, and it's I think it's very simple to defend. Of course, you can go very deep in it and meta ethics and things like that. But again, you're not going to be dealing with that with most people.
Hold on, let's say part one of the argument is
premise one, and premises are steps in an argument. And in philosophy, we have deductive arguments where a series of steps will lead forcibly to a conclusion. Meaning, if the premises are true in a logically valid argument, the conclusion follows necessarily. It's unavoidable if the premises are true. So, for example, our first premise is, if God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist. That's essentially saying if God exists, objective moral values do exist.
And we know they exist.
That's I'm just saying the logical equivalent in the reverse.
Right.
And I promise I won't get too technical, but these are some important distinctions so you know what a good argument is. The reason I like to frame it in the reverse when I say if God does not exist, objective moral values do not exist is because we all feel and experience that objective moral values do exist. So the first premise is actually pretty repelling to people when it wakes people up, right? Because we all want to affirm that what Hitler did was actually wrong, that torturing and raping babies is actually wrong, right? And this is a properly basic belief. We sense it as being as true to us as the external world, for example, that there is a such thing as truly right and truly wrong. And that helps to affirm premise number two, that objective moral values do exist. But if objective moral values exist, then God must exist. And this is a very simple argument that you can use that I found is a very good one for getting attention and things like that. Now, you might be debating an existentialist atheist like I was today who says that, well, how do you know objective moral values exist? And I would say it's a properly basic belief. It's not my job to establish that the outside world exists, something that is just obviously true through experience. It's your job to, as the skeptic, to provide some argument against what is so common to experience. And this is what I spent 2 hours debating this woman with. And the short answer is there's no good reasons that anybody can give against the existence of objective moral values that are more obvious than the moral values themselves, that the Holocaust is wrong or things like that, or that we couldn't give against the existence of the external world. Now, I don't know if you want to go into some of those or if you just want to outline some of these arguments. We can link to my episodes where I go into depth.
Yes, that sounds like a good idea.
But this is a very simple argument that helps us to establish the existence of God based on our moral conscience and a properly basic experience that, yes, there is a such thing as truly right and wrong. And for that to even be possible, there must be some type of transcendent moral authority that we ground that in. You cannot have a truly right and wrong on a purely atheistic, naturalistic worldview. The best you can have is moral relativism, where all morals are purely the result of evolution. And it really is just, you know, if you want to be a cannibal, that's as valid as me wanting to be a saint. And the great thing about that argument is nobody wants to say that. Nobody wants to say that that Hitler and Mother Teresa live morally equivalent lives. Nobody wants this. That would be the position that they would have to take if they want to argue against that. And a good argument is often just trying to raise the intellectual stakes so high that if somebody's going to deny any part of the argument, they would appear very absurd like that.
That would certainly make people absurd.
And it did today. I'm presenting it.
Did you actually give those two?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, they're the same, right?
Yeah. So that's one basic argument. Another one that is a very simple argument is called the Kalam cosmological argument. And this is we can go into the background of the naming of it. Very simple argument. Again, premise one, everything that begins to exist has a cause. Premise two, the universe began to exist. Conclusion, the universe has a cause. And then we can just think about that for a second, realize that if the universe had a cause, that cause must be beyond the universe, which means beyond space and time. It must be extremely powerful to bring the universe into being, must be possessed of intellect and will, and so forth. Essentially, it derives us all the qualities of that which we would call God.
Can we get to a triune God philosophically?
No. So the important, and this is why I would say philosophy helps us to build a cumulative case for Christianity. Is there any questions about that last?
You know, this is hard because I've heard you say these so many times. Now you've been, and I've asked my questions over the course of many months at this point, but you were debating this today, and you've been debating it pretty frequently, especially lately. Have you heard of any questions or things people just aren't understanding that you think?
Well, I think that this one is a really good argument, because not only is it a simple argument to memorize, I think it's a simple argument to understand. It's not like an argument like from contingency, which is one of my favorites. It is a little more technical. but again, everything that begins to exist has a cause. And we think on our experience, is there anything that began to exist that we can think of that didn't have a cause?
Yeah.
Pretty much the entire scientific enterprise is based on the idea that things have causes, and we will look for those causes and explanations. Now, people will try to deny that premise. But again, I think to deny that premise would cause them to appear absolutely absurd. Because if you don't think that things have causes, you might as well just sit around in your living room and wait for Michael Bolton to appear. And we don't see people really living that kind of way. Like, we expect causes for things. Like, if Michael Bolton did appear, my first reaction would be like, how the heck did you get here, Michael Bolton? Right? Teleportation or something. I just wouldn't expect something to pop into existence without a cause. It's worse than magic, right? Premise two, that the universe began to exist, we can use both philosophical arguments and scientific evidence. The current state of affairs in Big Bang cosmology tells us that the universe had an absolute beginning. And so here we can use scientific evidence to support a premise in a logical argument.
For some reason, I haven't thought about Michael Bolton in a long time. I'll tell you what, I went to high school with a kid whose name was Michael Bolton.
Did you really?
Yes.
But I bet he just didn't pop a high school uncaused.
He didn't, no. He made a lot of teachers laugh. It was beyond us at this point. Mm-hmm. A little too young.
So I think that there are many, many, many great arguments like this for the existence of God, and there are just not anywhere near equally good arguments for atheism when it comes down to it. So for the person who is interested, it's these types of arguments, because people say, there's no evidence for the existence of God. I'm like, hold on, I just gave you some arguments, and these are logically deductive arguments. So if you don't agree with the premises, you have to tell me why you don't agree with them or why they're wrong. Otherwise, the conclusion follows necessarily whether you like it or not. And that's why philosophy and logic is very important, because when somebody who just has never taken the time to look at the other side says something like, oh, well, there's no evidence or there's no reasons, you then have really good arguments and reasons.
Yeah. And I would say, coming from, previously being a moral relativist and atheist, I didn't even really know this other side existed logically. I was like, oh, these are just all Bible thumpers. They go off feelings only. So if you are coming up against somebody who's these arguments are coming up, they might not even realize that they are up against some very deep logic.
Yeah. And like I said, that often it's enough. Often just presenting the reasons is enough. They might not even want to go in depth in the arguments, because it might be the first time that they've ever heard them and they wouldn't even know how to respond. So that's why I said just kind of memorizing a few of these arguments, and maybe memorizing some of the common objections to them, not maybe the deepest or all of the objections, is really going to be, I think, quite effective for the vast majority of people, the vast majority of the time, and showing that, hey, our faith is reasonable. It's not just, it's certainly far more reasonable than the atheistic position. And having those in your arsenal is really powerful. So I like to build the cumulative case. Again, if somebody's got problems with the existence of God, we use these philosophical arguments to show that there is a timeless, spaceless, a transcendent, immaterial, all-powerful, all-loving creator of the universe. And then once we agree on that, we can start to look at the historical evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ.
Well, actually, you just touched on something. Why do we, I don't know if I'm just opening a big can of worms here, but why, you said all-loving. Mm-hmm. How do we know that our God is all loving?
Well, there's a few ways. The moral argument would help us do that. And also something called the ontological argument, which is much more complex. But the ontological argument would say that God is that which nothing greater can be conceived. And obviously, a being that is worthy of worship is greater than a being that's not worthy of worship. Now, a being worthy of worship would have to be a being that is morally perfect. To be morally perfect would entail all loving of some degree. So ontological arguments or a priori arguments And the ontological argument, I think, is a very good one, but it's hard for people to understand. But the short answer is we have good philosophical arguments that help us get at the character of God. The moral argument is also one of them. The moral argument, the one that we gave, helps us to also discern the moral character of God, because these objective moral values are a reflection of God's character. They're not just arbitrary things that he will. There's that famous Euthyphro dilemma, which is a false dilemma in philosophy, where it says, well, does God is something good just because God wills it, or does God will something because it's good? And both of these would seem problematic, because it seemed like that God just willed arbitrarily that something is good, or that there is some type of goodness that is above God. But if something is above God, then how could he be the greatest conceivable being? But the right answer is that God himself is, his character is inherently good. So he is willing a reflection of his very own goodness. That's why it's a false dilemma. The answer is between the horns. So the ontological argument, the moral argument helps you get at the goodness and lovingness of God. The Kalam argument does not. That says nothing about his moral character. So not all philosophical arguments tell you all about God's attributes or things like that. That's why I prefer a cumulative case. But same thing, once you build the case for Jesus and you establish the validity of his resurrection, show that it's more plausibly true than not to accept that, obviously that tells you an immense amount of God's moral character as well. Yeah. So that just adds to the case. And I think it's important when sharing our faith to let people know that it's, you know, maybe you might not find one piece of evidence. It's like a court of law. Maybe you find this argument is somewhat convincing, or this one somewhat convincing. But when you have all this evidence and all these arguments, that's when the case, I think, goes from convincing to compelling. Now, I happen to think that some of these arguments by themselves are extremely compelling alone. But then when you pile them all together, it converted me.
Right. Yeah.
So I think maybe that's kind of where we maybe leave this one, is just start to look at some of the basic philosophical arguments for the existence of God. We can link to some of my episodes where I've gone through some of these if people were interested. And then maybe next time we can look at the sort of mere Christianity picture of the historical evidence for the resurrection of Jesus, and then continue to build that case straight into Catholicism. I would say that if people want an accessible book that is a great starting point for a lot of these arguments and that will help you share and defend your faith, I would say Mere Christianity by C.S. Lewis.
It's funny, growing up, I remember first, I didn't realize that the Narnia books were Christian. Mm-hmm. And then I was like, what is that? What do you mean it's Christian? What is this? Who is this guy? You know, so, and then I, you know, the Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, the movie came out or whatever. So I didn't even realize that C.S. Lewis was something other than a writer.
That's right. Yeah.
I just thought, I was like, oh, he's a writer. What? I didn't realize. I mean, he did a lot of evangelizing, a lot of great work, a lot with his fireside chats, just like this. On the radio.
And his philosophy is top notch. So far as I'm concerned, his arguments are as good today as they ever were. So it's not like he's outdated or anything like that.
Right. Which I remember you thinking that may be the case until you started really getting into it. And I've been reading it here and there, and it's so enjoyable to read. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of it is Mere Christianity itself is transcriptions that he then edited. Mm-hmm. Right. So these are radio broadcasts from the 1930s.
I think of after World War II.
Oh, so the 40s.
When he started to do it. Yeah.
Okay. And they have a very warm feel to them. They read very easily. And it really breaks down philosophical arguments. Mm-hmm. Again, I'm not minded in this way, and I am able to.
Well, that's the other thing we can take away from C.S. Lewis is the delivery style. Not only are the arguments good, but he knows how to deliver the message in a way that makes, I would say, pretty much anybody receptive to it, in both the warmth of his style, how he anticipates many objections and answers those beforehand. And that's a really important part of evangelization. You know, like, we might have really good arguments, but if we go up to somebody and be like, hey, here's why you're wrong, right?
Everybody likes to be told why they're wrong.
They're just not going to listen to us. And guess what? We might be right. They could be wrong, but you know, it's, I think it's important to remember. And I try to remember this all the time, especially when people annoy me, is that I'm not trying to be right. I'm not trying to win an argument. I'm trying to save a soul.
And that's great.
you know, you have to sometimes put the ego aside, do a little bit more listening and, you know, think, how can I present this argument as gracefully as I can to really try and convince this person, not just prove that I'm right.
Right. I gotta say, I think we've really don't talk about religion and politics. That's all we talk about when we're out with at dinners.
Well, it's what G.K. Chesterton said, and I just wrote an article on this. Is it rude to talk about religion? He's like, I only talk about religion and politics because there's nothing else worth talking about.
Yeah, this is the most important thing. Mm-hmm. God is the most important thing. You should be talking about it. And if you're not being a jerk, you can have these conversations.
That's right.
All right. Well, thank you so much for listening. We will continue our talk on apologetics in the next several episodes. Thank you.
Don't forget to head over to thecatholicmama.com to get your free copy of How to Talk to Your Kids About God. This handy little ebook will teach you how to broach the topic of God with your children or how to respond to your kids when they want to talk about God, as well as give you answers to 7 of the trickiest questions about the faith that Christian parents face. You'll love the easy-to-understand grown-up answers, the pared-down but not talked-down answers you can share with your kids, plus recommended resources if you'd like to deepen your understanding of the topic. Get yours free at thecatholicmama.com.
We hope you enjoyed the program and will join us back for another show on WCAT Radio. This is Sebastian Mahfood. Good day.